Hey everybody!
Today, Rahdo runs through Lorenzo il Magnifico, which is a new Renaissance-era Euro-style economic simulation game. I'm going to be doing a two-player run-through today so you can see what it's all about. And I've already got the game set up here. As part of setup, each player has their own little Italian portfolio of stuff. As the first player, I'm going to start with $5, two lumber, two stone, and three servants. And Jen, she starts the same thing except she's got $6. Also, each player starts with their own personal bonus tile that gets snapped onto their starting area. And by default, everybody should have the same one that gives these same results. But as a more advanced version of the game, there are four different ones and they can be flipped. And then in reverse turn order, players grab them, which is what I've done. And Jen is the second player, chose to grab this one first. And then I chose to grab this one. Okay, so we've got those. Also, as part of the advanced setup, each player gets four leader cards, which we have to draft for. You draw four, you pick one, hand the rest over, pick another, hand the rest over, and so on. So I've already done the drafting for those. So I've got Sisto the Fourth and Ludovico the Third, Gonzaga, and all these, I assume, real historical Renaissance era Italian personages that, if I can get these guys deployed, will give me abilities for the rest of the game. Jen's got her four, I've got my four. We've each got our own special, unique starting bonuses we have access to. Jen has a little bit more cash than me. And then the last thing we have at the beginning of the game is we have four workers. This is a worker placement game. But the interesting thing about this worker placement game is not all workers are created equal. Each one of them is associated with one of these dice. And at the beginning of every round or age or whatever you want to call it, we're going to roll these dice. And that determines how strong each of these guys are. So if this were the roll, Jen's and my white guy are only have a value of 1. Our black guys have a value of 2, and our orange guys have a value of 2. So this would be a tough round because nobody is particularly valuable. But in a subsequent round, we might roll, and hey, that's a little better. Suddenly our sixes are awesome. They're super powerful, and our whites aren't too bad, but our oranges are still on the low side. Now, each of us has a fourth worker who's kind of the family dummy. He's not affected by any of these dice. He is always starting at level 0. He is always the lowest. And in fact, the rules don't talk at all about what the thematic explanation for these workers are. But the way Jen and I look at it is each one of our families has members in, like, probably the clergy, the aristocracy, or, you know, politics, and what the heck, I'm going to say military. And so, over time, you know, the prevailing winds of, a power in the Renaissance-era Italy change. And sometimes the clergy is strong, sometimes it's weak, sometimes the military is strong, sometimes it's weak. But our family idiot is always going to be at level 0. And so, that's it. We've got our starting setup. Also, as part of setup, there are, 16 development cards out here. 4 greens, 4 blues, 4 yellows, and 4 purples. These all give us access to different special abilities. And the main thing we're going to be doing over the course of this game is doing worker placement to grab these cards so they can give us all kinds of benefits so we can get our economic engine started. These were all chosen randomly. Next round, the other 4 level 1. So every time you play, you're always going to see, no matter what the player count is, all of the cards. It's just a matter of what order they come out in, what order they're available. And then the last thing, because I'm playing a 2-player game, you may not have noticed, but look at this! Camouflage! Some of the areas on the board are covered up to tighten up the worker placement a little bit. So these spaces are all gone because I'm only playing a 2-player game. Gotta say, I really like this nice touch just to make those spaces pretty much disappear completely. Right, so we're ready to go. I've already pulled all the stuff. We've done our initial drafts. Let's roll the dice to see how strong our family members really are. Okay, and there we go. So I am the first player, and I am going to, on my turn, place one of my workers in here, 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 or here, 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 here. You know, basically to grab one of those cards. And let's see. Now, what should I do? What should I chase after? There's a bajillion options available to me. Well, because these are the leaders I've got, These are all kind of giving me potential objectives to chase after, because each one of these leaders has a prerequisite I have to meet. To be able to get Sisto the Fourth on my side, I have to have on hand 6 lumber, 6 stone, 6 servants, and 6 bucks. If I do that as a bonus, the main thing I'm going to do on my turn is play one of my workers and do whatever the worker placement says. But as a bonus, I could call upon the services of Sisto if I've met these requirements, and then I would have access to his special power for the rest of the game. So knowing I've got these, well, I probably want to start chasing after getting a whole bunch of servants, 15 servants on hand, or 10 stone on hand, or 6, 6, 6, and 6 of all 4 resources, or to get Lucrezia here, I need 6 development cards of the same color. So if I have 6 greens or 6 purples, and this is going to take a while, I could get that bonus. Now, I should say, all of these are tough to do. There's no way you're going to get all 4 of these done over the course of the game. It's, I think, completely impossible. You just don't have enough time to achieve all 6 of these things. Even if you did draft and you tried to get overlap, because I do have some overlap. I got to get 6 of everything for this. And then if I keep on going, hey, 10 of this and 15 of this. So these kind of piggyback off each other, but there's no way I'm going to get all of them done. It's just, I really have to focus. So the other thing I can do is on my turn, any one of these that I think, you know what, there is no way I am ever going to be able to call upon the help of Lucrezia over here, you can go on ahead and discard the card to immediately get 1 council bonus. This is a place you can normally go with one of your workers to get a council bonus and fight for, you know, player order, because every time you come here, the first person to come here will be the first player in the next round. And they will also get a council bonus anytime I want. Heck, I've got 4 council bonuses. I could discard all 4 of these immediately, giving up all the potential for all these bonuses to get 4 council bonuses if I want. So, anyway, this is what I got to think about. And, you know, I could go for the 6666, but the benefit of having Sisto the Fourth, who clearly is some kind of cardinal, on my side is every time I try to pay tribute to the church, which only happens 3 times over the course of the game. It happens at the end of round 2, round 4, and round 6. If every time I do that, if I succeed, I can get 5 extra points. So this isn't really, I mean, so this is, if I could do this really quick and I keep making the church happy, this could be 15 points for me at the end of the game, but I'd have to work really, really hard on that. You know what? I think I'm gonna make it my life's goal to go after Ludovico, because, you know, once I've got him, every round I get 1 extra council bonus, which could be a lifesaver. Sometimes you just need 1 more stone or 2 more bucks, so I'll be able to get whatever I need. But to do that, I need to get 15 servants. And the reason, one of the reasons I chose this in the draft is because I saw all the cards that are out and I said, hey, look at this. If I participate in hosting panhandlers, I can get 4 servants right there. And if I take this village into my own domain, I could get 1 extra servant every round. Plus, if I get this monastery, if I build this monastery, I can get a servant there. So there's a few different ways for me to get servants. Plus, I can always get servants coming over here. So I think I'm gonna make it my goal to try and get to 15 servants as fast as possible so I can take advantage of this bonus for the rest of the game. That's my goal. I'm not saying it's the smartest one, but what the heck. I mean, mostly because there's that 4 right there. It's just sitting there. So with that in mind, this gives me some guidance about what I want to chase after. And I do want to participate in hosting panhandlers. Now to do this, I need to send my worker into this space, and I will need to provide 3 wood to no doubt build the sheds that the panhandlers will live in. Now at the beginning of the game, I've only got 2 wood, so I need 1 more wood before I can host panhandlers. How do I get wood? Well, I can always come over here to the council where my council bonus could be 1 stone and 1 wood. Or I could, let's see, what other ways are there to get wood? If I come over here, if I get this forest added to my domain, it's a place where I will immediately harvest 1 wood, and then later on, as you know, every round I have the chance to harvest 3 more wood. So if I get that, that would be a lot of wood over the course of the game, but I only need 1 to do this. So you know what? I think right off the bat, so I'm thinking, well, do I want to chase after this right away? Here's the thing. I don't have to worry about Jen snagging that right out from underneath me necessarily, because it's not like she has wood. It's not like this. I don't have to worry necessarily about her trying to snag that right away. Is there something I should do first that's even more important to me? Let's see here. Well, I mean, the main thing I want to do is I want to grab all these cards. They're all good. They're all powerful. But there's a couple of restrictions about sending my workers out. Remember how the workers have different strengths? You will notice these worker placement spots have different strength requirements. If I want to come over here and do this hosting panhandlers, I can send any of my workers who has a strength of one. Now, all my three guys have a strength of one, but my family member, my not so smart guy, he has a strength of zero. He can't come here. But if I ever want to send a worker to a place and they do not have enough value, like if I want to send my orange guy who only has a value of two over here where I need a value of three, so he can't come here normally, I can always use a servant. And for every servant I send along with my family member, they become one pip stronger. Now remember, I don't want to use my servants. I want to hold on to them because I'm trying to save up to 15. So, with that in mind, although that's kind of a bummer because my dumb family member, he can't do anything. With a zero, there's literally no place he can go without the help of a servant. He needs at least one to turn into a one so he could go any place. So if I try to save all of my servants, well then, this guy, well, you know what? Okay, with that in mind, I think I do know where I'm going to go first. You know, there's all these cards. I could be the first to grab any of these 16 cards. I'm going to hope Jen doesn't take the one I'm eyeballing. And instead, I am going to send my guy who's really not that smart. And I'm going to sacrifice one of my valuable servants. Because, I didn't mention, over here in the town square, there are these spaces. And again, you need to have a guy of at least value one. I'm going to save my servant because I might need him for something else. I will send my clergy family member because he's only a two. That means he's a higher value than one. He can come here. And my benefit is the lightning bolt meets immediately. I immediately get five servants. Boom. So I'm on my way. I've got eight of the 15 servants I need. Hurrah. All right. That was my first turn. Jen's turn. Let's see. Now, and I'm the only person who could come here. This space is blocked off. Can't go there now. Now, I've totally forgotten when I was drafting, what was Jen going for? Oh, I think she likes this guy. She needs to have 7 military strength and 3 favor with the clergy to be able to call upon Sigismondo Malatesta. All right. And the power of this is, for the rest of the game, her guy, who is normally a zero, suddenly becomes a minimum of 3. That's a big, big deal. Jen's very excited about that. So she wants to get her military, in the beginning of the game, we have no military, and her clergy up. So she wants to do something that will help her with both of those. So how does she increase her military? Well, we got to look around for bonuses that show this. Say, oh, that would increase your military by 1. This would increase your military by 2. I haven't even looked at the cards for Jen's perspective. Ooh, if she completes hiring recruits, well, now this is going to cost her $4. She starts with 6. It costs her $4. This will immediately increase her, her military by 5, getting her almost as far as she needs to go. And it'll give her, this is the symbol for the end of the game, this arrow, this will give her 4 points at the end of the game. I think Jen likes that. She likes that a lot. Now, to get up here, though, she needs to send somebody with a strength of at least 5. Because the higher you go up the tower, the more expensive it is. So, Jen, she has a 2 and a 2 and a 6 and a 0. So she's going to send Mr. 6 all the way up here. And because she's just come here, she immediately, lightning bolt meets immediately, makes $1. Although, this buck cannot go towards the purchase cost. So to be able to get this card, Jen needed 4. This extra buck doesn't help her with that. But anyway, she gets a buck and she's going to spend 4 to complete this goal of hiring recruits, which has immediately, boom, shot her military up quite a bit. She is on her way. 2 more military and then 3 clergy. She'll be able to get this guy into play. All right. And now, that has created a problem for me. Because there's a couple of restrictions about being able to go to the towers. First of all, if you are the first player to go to a given tower, like in Jen's case, he was the first to go to these projects tower, you know, where these sometimes they're military, sometimes they're social, you know, there's all kinds of things they are. If you're the first player to go there, you just got to send a guy who's the right level. But if a tower's already occupied, if somebody else wants to go later, they have to forfeit $3 to be able to go. And in this game, money gets very tight very quickly. So now the gen's occupied. Remember, I was planning on coming over here, but I figured, hey, I'd go there later with one of my guys to be able to get this. But now for me to go here, I gotta pay $3 to the bank. So that's why maybe I should have rushed over here really quick and gotten in before Jen. Because even then Jen didn't want what I wanted, she's still tacitly blocking me. I'm going to have to pay $3 to get in there now. Curses! All right. That is if I go for that. I don't have to go for that. I mean, like I said, there are other ways to get the servants. Or I could say, to heck with it, I don't care about collecting 15 servants. But because, heck, I've got 6 servants now. I'm on my way. I'm a quarter of a way to completing Sisto. In fact, heck, I've almost got enough money. I could give up on that because Jen has now blocked me out of here and change my plans and go for this instead. Maybe that's the smarter thing to do. Because I've got my 6. I just need one more dollar, but I need a bunch of stone and a bunch of lumber. Wow, that changes everything. Maybe I should chase after something else instead. For instance, over here, remember I mentioned this forest? This forest will immediately give me 1 lumber, and then every time I activate it, and you can activate your region cards, and you can have up to 6 region cards, you can activate them once per turn, they will get to generate. So this is a way for me to generate lots of lumber very quickly. And you know, you need lumber for stuff like hosting panhandlers, or building a mint, or building a theater, or what's this one over here? Raising a statue. Lumber is very, very important, very valuable. Right, so I was going to go for this, but now that Jen's blocked me out of there, I don't want to have to throw $3 after it, so to heck with it. My plans have changed immediately. I am going to use my top man, my number 6, and I'm going to come over here to the forest. Because now, unfortunately, you'll notice, to get into this space, I actually need a 7. Of course, nobody is ever a 7. So for this guy to come here, I also have to use one of my servants. So I give up a servant to turn this 6 into a 7, and I am going to claim this forest. And now, by the way, as a bonus for making it all the way up here for this highest, most valuable space, I just made 2 lumber. So just like that, I am now well on my way to completing the Sisto one instead, which was not my original plan. Crazy. Okay. But like I said, this could be worth 15 points if I play my cards right. So anyway, now, I got 2, plus this is showing that, again, the lightning bolt meets instantly. Instantly, upon receiving this, I get 1 more lumber, the same way Jen got 5 military immediately. And this now comes over here. One of the things I can do on a future turn is send my worker over here to the production space. If I spend a worker to the production space, or one of my family members, that means all my green cards will get activated and do their main action. So, before the round is over, I probably want to do that to get 3 more lumber out of this. Although, if I can, I'd like to get another green building first so that, hey, let's activate 2 buildings instead of 1. But here's the tricky thing. There is another restriction for placing your workers on the board. If any player has already been there, you got to pay $3 to be able to go. The other thing is, I cannot send 2 of my main family members to the same tower. So I can't have my black one and my orange one both come here. My orange one has to go to one of these other places. Comes over here, it's going to cost me $3. Coming over here, it just, you know, costs maybe servants depending on how high I go. But remember how I said, the dim-witted member of your family isn't that great because he's only a 0. You have to give him servants to help him do anything. He does have 1 benefit. He doesn't count as a full color character. So you can't have 2 greens here, but I can have a green and a neutral. So the family slowpoke is the one who lets you do 2 actions in a given, and I probably want to do that. I probably want to make sure he comes over here to get another one of these. So before I activate my production row, I'll have 2 cards instead of 1. So anyway, that was my second action. First I got some servants, then I got a forest in my domain. Back over to Jen. She's still got 3 workers raring to go. And she still needs 2 more military, and she needs 3 clergy. Now, the military is needed for a couple of things. I mean, this is a bonus need. The main thing you need military for is some of these project cards that come out require military. Interestingly, none of these starting ones did, but we know that means in round 2, a bunch of military requirements are going to come out. So the more military you have, the more military projects you can do. Or military campaigns. The other reason you need military is Let's see. If you, well, actually, come back over here to me. You'll notice the first green card I put down didn't cost me anything. Second one doesn't cost me anything. Third one, I cannot put my, I cannot expand my domain to a third card unless I've got three military. Then I need seven military to go higher, and 12 and 18. So if I want to have, by the end of the game, six green cards, I'm going to need a lot of military. But having six green cards, which is a big goal, that's something I would chase throughout the whole game, at the end of the game, that scores me 20 points. Plus, let's not forget this guy. Good old Lorenzo, who I was thinking about dumping. If I get six of one color card, I can turn them in, and that increases all of my regular family members by two pips. It makes them all more powerful. So, because Jen blocked me out of there, I think that's changed everything. I'm dumping him. I am now going for getting six greens, so I can do that, and trying to get Sisto and keep my piety up as well. Now, so the military has a couple of uses, in addition to maybe special case uses here and there. The getting your favor with the church is very important too, because at the end of the second, the fourth, and the sixth round, and there's only sixth round in this game, so at the end of every other round, we are going to be tested. And if we do not, in the third round, have at least three favor, or I'm sorry, in the second round, the first time we're tested, we have to have three favor. The next time we're tested, at the end of round four, we have to have four favor. And at the end of the game, at the end of round six, we must have five favor. If we do not have enough favor with the church at those moments, we become excommunicated. These, I mean, and you could get excommunicated three times. Every time you get excommunicated, one penalty is applied to you that lasts for the entire game. And these can be particularly painful penalties. Although, depending on your strategy, you might not care about the penalty at all. The last penalty is always some kind of point loss at the end of the game. This penalty, if at the end of the game I get excommunicated, I will lose 1 point at the end of the game for every yellow building I have built that, for every lumber and stone I've built building yellow buildings. Now here's the thing. I could make a decision. Because this is in the game, right from the get-go, I'm never going to build a single yellow building. Because if I don't care about these yellow buildings, I don't care about this excommunication, and that's one less thing for me to worry about. This one is important to me, though, because this one's, if I get excommunicated at the end of round two, and this happens to me, for the rest of the game, because I can't undo it, for the rest of the game, doing production suffers a three-pip penalty. Which means, because when I do production, I need to do production with five, with a level five worker to be able to activate this forest. This, if I suffer from this, I'll suffer a three penalty. So I don't want that production penalty because now I'm thinking, hey, I want to go heavy, heavy, heavy into production. So that's changed everything. So I got to make sure by the end of round two, I have at least three piety or three favor with the church so I don't get excommunicated. Jen, she has another reason to get the church. All this is so you understand. I mean, there's a lot of interplay, a lot of interconnectedness. Jen needs to have this three piety. So with all that in mind, what is she going to do? Well, this is interesting. She's kind of drawn to this preacher. First of all, nobody has gone to the blue column yet, so she won't have to pay $3. She won't have to throw money away to be the first person to come here, if she's the first to come here. Also, she only needs a level one pip guy, so she could send one of her low guys over here and get him pretty easily. And now, it's going to cost $2 to hire this guy. She has the money, though. And she will immediately get four piety, just like that. That's really powerful for early in the game, but there's a downside. This guy will give her a permanent problem for the rest of the game. Whenever she goes to the level 5 or the level 7 row, she will not get the benefit. Remember how she came over here and she got a buck as a free benefit? If she gets this preacher, she has to, well, because she's got a preacher on hand, she has to go for a life of forgoing the finer things, right? She has to go a bit more austere, which means she cannot take these high-level bonuses. But on the flip side, the sooner she gets this done, the sooner she turns her slow guy into a wunderkind. So I think, yeah, it's crazy, but she's going to do it. She's going to send her white guy, who is only a 2, over here, their clergy guy. That's fine, only costs 1. She's the first person on the blue, so she picks this up for $2. So that's going to cost her 2. She's almost broke now. And now, we're supposed to put all our purples off the board over here and all our blues over here, but that would go off the camera, so I'm just going to put them all up here. Jen now has a preacher. She immediately Boom, 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 boom. She's at level 4. She has met the needs for the end of the round. Now she just needs 2 more military, and she can get Sigismondo on her team. All right, but she has suffered a penalty. For the rest of the game, she will not get... She can still put workers here to get these cards, but she won't get these instant benefit bonuses. So we'll see how well that works out for her. Back to me. I got another worker, and I got 2 more workers. And let's see now, what am I going to do? Man, I keep forgetting. Oh, right. Oh, I want to go and get more green. More green. I want to, because before I run my green, I want to have. So that means I'm going to have to send my family not so smart guy because, now, first of all, I will have to pay 3 extra bucks because I'm already occupying. If anybody occupies this column, I got to pay $3. So I'm paying $3. Ouch. And this guy is not smart enough to go here, here, or here. So I'm going to have to send some assistance along with him. But if I don't, I won't get a chance to go to this column at all. So where do I want him to go? If I send 1 assistant, I can pick this up. If I give him 3 assistants, I can pick up the citadel as opposed to village. If I give him 5 assistants, and remember, I picked up. I do have 5 assistants because originally I was thinking I was going to go after this. Then he can get the monastery. Let's see here. Now, what the Citadel does is, it does nothing for me immediately, but when it gets activated, that is 2 shields, or 2 military, and 1 stone. The village is $1 and 1 assistant, or 1 servant, and the monastery, immediately 2 military, 1 servant, and every time I activate this, increase my piety and get stone. And if I come here, I'll immediately get more wood. But here's the problem. I gotta spend 5. Ouch. This is kind of painful. Aye, aye, aye. But if I do it, I spend all 5 to come up here. Because here's my thing. That means I'm only leaving this guy who has a 2. And my last thing is, I'm going to have him do production so that he can activate stuff. But since he's a 2, he won't be able to activate this 5. And he won't be able to activate this 6. So that means he needs more. And I just got rid of all of them. But I do have a plan. It's crazy, but I think I'm going to do it. I'm going to send my not-so-bright member of the family over here. And to get into his 5, I needed to give up 5 assistants. It's a good thing I got them over here right from the get-go. And now, my reward, I immediately get 1 more lumber. And I take this card. It is my 2nd card. And I immediately get 2 military. And I immediately, hey, at least I got 1 assistant back. So really, that only cost me 4 assistants. And now, that was my turn. And I've got 1 more family member for this round who has a value of 2. Back over here to Jen. I've totally forgotten what Jen is doing, what she is after. Oh, right. Oh, right. She needs military. She needs 2 more military, and then she could get this guy out, turning him from a 0 to a 3, from a 0 to a hero. That's a big deal. Can Jen get 2 more military really quick-like? Yes, she can. I'll tell you how she's going to do it. She's going to take this guy, her nobility, who is not particularly strong. She is going to come over here. She's not going to grab another card. Because remember, she only has 1 buck. She can't afford to come to this column, and she can't go to either of these columns because she's already put a regular. She could come over here, but these all need resources. Instead, Jen's going to come down here. He's a value 2, so that means she can get in because you need a value of 1. Jen has now fixed it. So in the 2nd round, she will be the first player, and she immediately makes 1 buck, or florin, and she gets 1 council favor of her choice. You know what council favor she's going to take? 2 military. Bippity bop. Yep, there we go. And just like that. Now, before her turn is over, she only places 1 worker. But in addition to that, she can summon her leaders. She's going to summon this guy. She doesn't have to pay this. She just has to have achieved it. She has 7 military. She has 4. You only need 3. And Sigismondo is now on her team. And this is a permanent ability for the rest of the game. This now has a little number 3 on it instead. Wow, that was a big thing. So Jen, and now, so we'll see what she does with that in a second. But now for my last action, I'm going to come over here and I'm going to do some production. This is only a 2. I can use my, so that's a 3, 4, 5, but I need it to be a 6 to activate this monastery I got. My 5 will activate this, but if I want to activate this, I have to go here with a strength of 6. So I need 1 more servant. How am I going to get it? Remember, I said right up front, you can discard any of these to immediately get a council bonus. I'm going to throw this guy away. I've given up on Ludovico, and so he's out of the game. I immediately get 1 of these. The benefit I will take will be 2 servants, And then I will spend one of them, and just like that, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I am doing production with a value of 6, which means I come over here. Now, first of all, whenever I do production, I get, this is my personal customized bonus, 1 stone, 1 lumber, and 1 servant. Hey, look at that. So, didn't cost quite so much. And I'm just drowning in lumber. I'm gonna start building stuff like crazy in the future. So first of all, I do that. Now I activate any of these that I can afford, and I can afford both because I went with a strength of 6. So I get 3 more lumber. Oh my gosh. I'm gonna have to take one of these 5s. There we go. Let's see, because I get 3. I'll just take 3 more. Although I'm almost out. Yeah, I'm gonna have to start switching. So I'll take 3 more lumber, and I activate this as well, which gives me 1 on the church and 1 more stone. Wowzy wow. I got a ton of goods, folks. And remember, I'm trying to get 6 servants. I need 6 bucks. I need 6 of everything to be able to get this guy on side. So I'm looking at maybe getting both of these done. Although, heck, I'm making so much stuff, maybe I'll get the stone done as well. But anyway, that was it. That was my final worker. And now here's the thing. In a 2-player game, you only get 1 shot at production. At any time, Jen could have come over here. Even though she has no green building, she could have come over here just to get her bonus of stone, wood, and military. And if she had done that, it would have blocked me out, and I would have gotten nothing. So I'm really glad. I mean, it's important to go as quick as you can, because Jen, she could have blocked me out of that, but she was chasing after her own dreams, and she achieved them. Her dummy is a level 3, thanks to this guy, which gives her so much more flexibility. Now, unfortunately, she doesn't have the 3 bucks that would allow her to go to this column, or this column, because as a neutral, it could go to any of these places. But she could still go to this column. She could come over here and get another one. She could come over here and get 5 bucks. I think she'll do that. Since she really broke herself, she's just going to make some cash money. Boom. And that was her last turn. And now normally, as a level 0, she would have to give up a servant to let him come over here. But as it is, he's a level 3. That is what this is. Yeah, yeah, he's a level 3. And boom, she just made 5 bucks. That was it. That was the end of the first of 6 rounds. And now, if you guys would like to watch another round, because I'll play through 1 more round and get to the end of it so we can show how the excommunication stuff works, you can hit the little I in the top right corner of the screen and go to the extended playthrough, or alternatively, you can go to final thoughts. Your choice in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.